Okay, now I am going to talk about what are the conditions, the jump condition across shock waves. You know, what are the jump condition across waves? You know, I have talked about the jump condition across this simple equation that I showed to you, but now I take the equation of fluid mechanics, and what does I take the equation of the fluid mechanics. Here are the equation that I have written. This is a fluid mechanics without chemical reaction. Let me take this out. I don't know how to use this thing. All right. Sorry. Okay. Now, you know, I write here, these are the Euler equation. All right? That are written in terms of, that are written for a one-dimensional unsteady problem. And I have added here the energy conservation, which is the energy equation, which is written in terms, I have written the equation in the conservative form that I have discussed in the second lecture, okay? This has the conservative form. Why these forms are interesting to the problem of the jump? It's easy to understand, is when you work in a frame which is attached to the moving shock, you have a steady state problem, so that if you are steady all the time, all the term d over dt disappear. Now the distance x here is the distance that you have in the frame moving. So it is a steady frame, you work in this steady frame, and the conservation of mass tells you that rho u is constant. So rho u on the fresh mixture, I have pu rho u d, which is the velocity of the shock, okay? D, this strange d here, is the velocity of the shock, and the exit, it is called n, because it is for Neumann. This is Neumann was the one who was very, is a Neumann who worked on in math and so on, is a famous scientist. He was the one, in the 19th century, who was back to the early work of the Neumann is in the 20th century, and he was back to the early work of Rankine. Rankine was a Scottish engineer, scientist, let's say. And Hugoniot is a French who was a scientist also, but maybe more an engineer. So sometimes scientist and engineering, it's difficult to say the difference between a scientist and an engineer. But so N is for the Neumann state, which is the behind the shock, the gas is compressed. In front of the shock, the gas is the initial, and the U here that I use is because in detonation, this means unburned. And N means Neumann, just behind the shock. So in that case, the mass flux is constant, so you should have this conservation that links the two velocity of gas, or which is also D, the velocity of the shock in the quiescent initial gas, with the velocity of the gas relative to the shock, the velocity of the compressed gas relative to the shock, and this velocity is smaller because the density is higher. So if you conserve the mass, rho ud equal rho n un, and because rho n is larger than rho u, un is smaller than d. Now, same relation now for the momentum. I am in the steady state, so I have just to take into account that this quantity is constant. And then what I say is that there is no gradient, neither upstream nor downstream. So this term, viscous term, disappear from. And m here is the mass flux. And it's better to write rho u square as rho square u square divided by rho, okay? And then say that rho square u square is constant, is equal to m square divided by rho. So this is rho u on the cold side, and on the initial state, and rho n on the burn state. So you have two relations. And now, to close the problem, you need the energy equation. So remember the form of the conserved form of the energy equation. The conserved form of the energy equation is a flux here, d over dx, of rho u times the enthalpy plus u square over 2, which is called the total enthalpy. It includes the enthalpy of the gas plus the kinetic energy of the gas. So this rho u is constant, take it outside. Now, when you integrate this, both on both sides, the gradients are zero, so it does not play any role. So you have the difference of enthalpy between the shock gas and the shock gas and the initial gas, Hn minus Hu, is simply equal to the difference, because rho u is outside, is simply equal to the difference of the speed, un squared divided by minus d squared divided by 2. So now you have everything to work out, to find out what are the relation, what are the shock gas conditions for a given d. And this is simply you write, for example, here that the difference of pressure is the equal to the mass rate square minus the difference of the inverse of density, which are the specific volume. And on the other side, you have the difference of enthalpy, which is equal to, now I put that equal to, I multiply by rho and I divide by rho, so that in numerator I have m, mass flux, and now in denominator I have the density square, and I have the difference of the inverse of density square is here. So now when I write this here, and I use that, I decompose the difference of the square as the product of the difference plus the product plus the sum, and I use for the difference this relation, I obtain a relation between rho, rho n, and pn, which is written here. This is called the Hugoniot relation. Now, so the Hugoniot relation tells you what is the relation between density and specific volume across a shock wave, and you have another equation relating pressure and volume, specific volume, coming from this momentum equation here, which is called this in the phase plane p over rho, p 1 over rho, which is p specific volume. This is a straight line. And this now you have to use the expression of p of enthalpy. And so this expression of enthalpy is written here. It is CPT. It's energy plus P over rho. And this gives you gamma over gamma minus 1, P over rho. Gamma is the ratio of the specific heat. So now, in order to simplify the notation and to get rid of the unusual quantity, you use, I will use now in the following, this reduced pressure jump, which is reduced P over PU minus 1 and gamma, okay, and the reduced volume, specific volume jump, 1 over rho minus 1 over rho u, which is conveniently reduced. And now the Hugoniot relation takes this form, P plus 1 times nu plus this, okay, this strange P plus 1 multiplied by this strange V plus 1 equal 1. Very simple equation. And the other, which is Michelson Rayleigh line, which is written here, tell you that P and nu, and this big P, okay, and this velocity, and the pressure, and the reduced pressure and reduced specific volume are just linked by the Mach, Mach number of the propagation. Mach number of the propagation, mu, is d divided by AU, where AU is the speed of sound in the fresh mixture. Okay? So now, here is a picture. You know, this is an hyperbolic, this is an hyperbole. It is in blue here. This is my initial condition, 1 over rho u pu. This is all the possible solution behind in the Neumann state, and I just have to cross this with the Rayleigh line here, which is proportional, the slope of which is proportional to the Mach number square. So when I know the Mach number, which means when I know the speed of the shock, immediately by this construction, I obtain the condition behind the shock, tells you what is the pressure and what is the density here. And you see the density is larger in the Neumann than the Neumann, and the pressure is higher in the compressed gas behind than in front of it. So this is a very old result obtained during the 19th century in two different ways. I will explain you that later. And now here are the expressions you obtain for the velocity, the pressure, the temperature, and the Mach number, local Mach number, which is the Mn is the un divided by An, the sound, local sound speed, okay? So you have here the relation, these are, and it is interesting to notice that the relation between the Mach number in front, in the initial state, and in the shock gas, is a symmetric relation, you know, quite symmetric. You may change mu in an mn, and it does not change the relation. It does not change the relation. It's a symmetric relation. Okay, and here is the geometry. I like to make some general comment. First of all, I will not show that because you may find that every ordinary book in fluid mechanics. My advice is read the book of Landau and Lifshitz on fluid mechanics. I tell you that you will learn a lot reading this book. This is the best book in fluid mechanics, to my opinion. So you will find this comment in the book of, and not necessarily elsewhere. First of all, the entropy, you know, if you may plot, look for the, in this diagram, P of 1 over rho, you may look for the isoentropy curve and ask the question, how this isoentropy curve are positioned relatively to the Hugoniot curve. It turns out that the isoentropy curve are tangent. But even more, you know, if I have a very small density jump, you know, if this jump PU, my PN minus PU is small, the jump of entropy is of third order. not quadratic, third order, even smaller, which means that when you have a very weak shock, that is a shock where the density, the jump is very small, in fact, in that case, to first order, you may neglect the jump of entropy. How? In the same way as Riemann did. But this was right only for small photons. Now, the entropy between N and U is very large, the difference, when the shock is strong. So this is one point. The second point is that the Hugoniot relation is no, the Hugoniot curve is not an isofunction curve. What does that mean? What is an isofunction curve? An isofunction curve is a curve that you may write like that. H function of P and 1 over rho is given by its value on one point on this curve. So you this an iso function curve, H is a function, whatever it is, should have this type, should be written, should be possibly written in that form. If you look to this form, this is not the case. You cannot write the Hugoniot relation like that. Impossible. Because U is linked with P and rho, and you cannot separate a relation P of 1 over rho on one side and PU 1 over rho U of the other side. This means that the Hugoniot, this means that the Hugoniot is associated with an initial condition. And more precisely, if I take the Hugoniot with an initial condition n, for example, I can use that, why not? I will not find the same Hugoniot than the curve associated with the Hugoniot curve associated with the initial condition u. The two curves cross, and n and u, they have to cross because both of them give you the same relation. But in between, it does not work. Okay? This is something that few people understood. Now, another point is that the entropy is increasing because the entropy is increases here. When P increases and rho decreases, the entropy is increasing. So the entropy is increasing from U to N. And now, a curve, a singularity, no, excuse me, a discontinuity cannot go from N to U. It should go from U to N. Because why that? Just what I said before. Let me go back. Look, you know, an expanding wave is not a discontinuous function. It's a function which is quite unsteady with a thickness that increases with time. Contrary to shock wave, which is a function which in first approximation can be considered as a step function propagating with a given velocity. So expanding wave cannot propagate as a discontinuity. Expanding waves should be fully unsteady. So there is no expanding shock. This is the last comment. Now, it's easy to prove that the entropy of the fluid should increase through the shock. If you use the, for example, if you assume that you may use the equation of for the entropy that I have written here, and if you integrate with rho u constant here, you find that the jump of s in the direction of u, that is, when you do that, you gave a sign of U, and you look for the difference of, you integrate that. Excuse me. First, you, let me go slowly. First, you first assume that you may use this relation here, which is entropy conservation, which was obtained by using the fluid mechanical equation. It turns out that cannot be done for a strong shock. I will tell you why. But for weak shock, it is possible to do that. And in that case, if you integrate this, you will see that Sn minus Su, this disappears, and this is the integral of something which is necessarily positive, which is the production of entropy. So it is because so a shock wave is an irreversible process. No doubt. But if it is an irreversible process, what does that mean? That means that the dissipative effect should play an important role. Where? Inside. And when you are not interested to what is happening inside, you just say there is a jump of entropy. But you cannot have a decrease of the entropy, so you cannot have an expanding wave. That's impossible because of irreversibility. Now, how can you prove that if the shock is strong? That is, let me tell you why you cannot use now fluid mechanical equation in a strong shock. Because as you will see, the thickness of the shock in a gas is of the order of the mean free path. And hydrodynamical equations are valid only if the length, the characteristic length of variation of the quantity are much larger than the microscopic length. Otherwise, you do not have any macroscopic description. But, however, you can show that by using the Boltzmann equation, and so for those who are interested in that, and the H theorem of Boltzmann, that the entropy should increase across a strong shock. Okay, this is for. Okay, now let me now go to the detonation. Okay, CG detonation. Okay, now the difference when you have a detonation is that you have another energy that you have to take into account, which is the energy. The chemical energy. You do not conserve only the mechanical energy and the thermal energy, but you should conserve, I don't know, I don't see here, what I, you should conserve, where is it? Here. No, my goodness, where is it? Okay, here is the QM, no? Let me, I cannot see on the blackboard. Yes, you see, here is a, you should now add this chemical energy inside, the conservation of the total energy. This is the difference that you have. Okay, the difference is coming simply from the fact that you have to take into account the chemical energy compared to a shock wave. So now, if I come back to my reduced quantity here, I introduce the QM is the heat release per unit mass. I define a strange Q here, which is a reduced quantity by the entropy of the initial mixture. So this is non-dimensional, and now I found out an hyperbole, which is no longer the blue one, but which is shifted from the blue one upward by this quantity Q. So same construction. Now you have the Rayleigh line in red, and the intersection with the green curve give you the thermodynamic relation of the burned gas as soon as you know the slope here, and the slope is against the Mach number of propagation, which is a square, which is the ratio of the sound, of the velocity, the ratio of the propagation velocity of the detonation divided by the speed of the sound in the initial mixture, square. So as soon as you know now this the propagation velocity here, you know the state in the burned gas. Okay, this corresponds to this picture here. You know, when you have a piston pushing the gas in an inert gas, you have a shock wave. If you push the a reactive gas with a piston, you may have something different than a shock wave. You may have the reaction that is attached to the shock, and you may have a detonation. In that case, the burned gas is uniform, and you have. But one has to be careful to something. You see, because of the shift here, due to the Q, there is a minimum speed propagation. You know, if I am below this slope here, I have no solution. I cannot intersect the green curve. So there is a marginal solution, which is called, unfortunately, it is called Chapman-Jouguet. You know, it is not Chapman-Jouguet who discovered that. Chapman and Jouguet, this is beginning of the 20th century. This was obtained in a PhD thesis of a student in Moscow called Michelson. And so I tried to say Michelson Rayleigh line, but you know, and then Rayleigh is even much later than these people. So now you see this means that if the piston is sufficiently fast, you have a detonation. If the piston is not sufficiently fast, you do not have a detonation. What do you have? Depends. You may have an unsteady problem because this is steady, the structure is steady. You may have simply a shock wave without reaction and so on and so on. It is not so simple to guess what happened in that case. But if you are talking about detonation, real detonation, you cannot have detonation with a velocity smaller than the Chapman-Jouguet or Michelson velocity. And this Michelson velocity is not difficult to obtain because you just have to solve. You know, when I put this expression in this, I have a second an algebraic equation of second order for the reduced volume, reduced specific volume V. You may have used pressure. It's the same. And now, for a supersonic phenomena, you have a margin. See here. Here is a solution, okay. If you take the discriminant of this equation, it is the square of that minus 4 mu square times Q. You see that in order to have a real root of this equation, you should satisfy this condition. This means that when you look to when this inequality is satisfied, this is for mu larger than the mu, we call that Chapman-Jouguet. Now, I will call that Chapman-Jouguet, it's Michelson, but okay, which is square root of Q plus square root of Q plus 1. Do you remember now what I say when I was discussing my first lecture, the order of magnitude things? I told you, the velocity you may have is the square root of the heat release per unit mass. And you know what is the Chapman-Jouguet? It's twice this square root. No more, plus one. You see, the order of magnitude is correct. And this is why you are supersonic also, all right? So this is just to show you that simple, you know, this is to find that. It took some time to Michelson. It was his PhD thesis, you know. It's a full PhD thesis in 1890. Well, 91, no, I don't remember, 1890, 91. Wonderful. And unfortunately, this Michelson, I don't know why, does not become a great scientist. I don't know why. You know, he discovered something very important. Okay, he was lost. Maybe he was going to industry. I don't know. No, I am joking. I am joking. Industry is a very important thing. So now you see this marginal solution corresponds to a tangent here. And I told you that the isentropic curve are tangent to the Hugonio curve. So what does that mean? This means that here, the velocity of the gas relative to the shock is equal, exactly equal, to the speed of sound. And now you can, you see, because of the slope here, which is, you know, the absolute value of this slope is larger than this slope here, you are supersonic for the propagation velocity. But in the shock, relative to the shock, you are subsonic. You see, you compare the slope to the Hugonio, or the slope to the Michelson, or the extension of Hugonio with heat release. You know, the slope, the absolute value of the slope is larger. Here, it is smaller. So here you are subsonic, here you are supersonic. And now, here you are sonic. So the marginal solution, which is a Chapman-Jouguet solution, is marginal. Is yes, it is marginal, no doubt. But it's such that the sound, such that the velocity of the gas relative to the shock, or to the leading shock, this is equal to the local sound speed of sound, AB. So, okay, UB equal AB, which is written here. And this is very, very important because this also explains why you do not need any piston to have such a wave, self-propagating wave. Let me explain you. This is also explained in Landau and Landau and Lifshitz's book. Eh? It's no, for the moment it's not here. The velocity of the Vanian is subsonic. Okay, I said that. Okay. Before I go to this point, I just mentioned the following. In fact, it turns out, I am going to show you that you cannot go from U to B like that. You go first from U to the Neumann state, so you have a shock wave, followed by a reaction going from this Neumann point to this burn gas. And now, the same for here. You are going first to the Neumann and back by the reaction. And this was understood in the middle of the 20th century by many people, by three people, Neumann, Dering, and Zeldovich. But in fact, there is a paper by a French chemist in the beginning of the 20th century, very beginning, who have understood already. Because, you know, it is very, very disturbing that you may have something, an information on the a chemical reaction propagating faster than the sound. Why it is so perturbing? Because, you know, how can you propagate a reaction wave which is resulting of the inelastic shock in molecule at a speed larger than the speed of propagation of the, on average, of the molecules themselves. How is that possible? Many people were very, very concerned by that. Many stupid things were said about that in the 18th century, some talking about some radiation going faster than the matter and so on. Only Viel understood the fact that you can go by, you can do that by through a shock. You should have a shock first and a reaction later. So if I, my goodness, I don't know what. Now, okay, I have to go fast to this point. This point is the inner structure of a weak shock. The question is the following. Can I solve the problem in a continuous fashion to obtain the profile of the pressure, the density, and the temperature across a shock wave, for example? Now I am back to the shock wave, okay? Can I do that? It turns out that this is what exactly what did Rankine, in a way difficult to follow, but he did that. So just I want to tell you how to do that. First of all, this is possible only if the mechanical, if the fluid mechanical equation are valid. I'll tell you this is not possible for a strong shock. It is only possible for a weak shock when the difference of pressure is small. You will understand that better in a few minutes. So now, if you know what you have to do now to go continuously from the initial condition to the shock condition, you should keep the dissipative process, because as I told you, a shock is an irreversible process. So if it is an irreversible process, the inner structure of the shock should depend on the diffusive effect. But what is very important is that the jump does not depend. This is exactly the same thing as the model I showed to you when I add a small dissipative term epsilon. Remember? When you add a small dissipative term to the equation, the simplest hyperbolic equation I have written to begin with, you find out the jump that does not depend on this epsilon, but this epsilon allows you to go continuously from one value to the other value. So you have to keep, so let me go a little bit fast now. You have to be, to keep this, you have such a, now you have first order equation to solve. You can solve that. Okay. You know, there are a lot of calculation, forget about. And you will find the profile. This is what did Rankine to obtain the jump condition. So Rankine solved the problem to obtain the jump condition. He solved the problem for weak shock. And it obtained a jump condition. Because it turns out at the end that the jump does not depend on the diffusive process, this is also valid for strong shock. And the main contribution of Hugoniot 25 years later was to, he did not know the Rankine work, Hugoniot. At least he did not mention in his work. That you may find that in the library of Polytechnique School in Paris. What did Hugoniot? He did not solve the inner structure. He just did what I do, it's conserve the total energy. He just had the total energy conservation, and he found out the result. Now, let me, so it's easy to find out, I will show you the result. It is easy to find out the result. Now, I want to go to dimensional analysis once again to give you the best, the cheapest insight in the problem. I want to know what will be the order of magnitude of the thickness of the shock. This is my problem now. Oh, don't worry, it's easy. You have, why don't you balance this chemical energy with this dissipation here that you have in the equation, in this equation where it is written mu, right here. You know, rho u squared mu du sur the x. Balance these two terms and try to see what kind of order of magnitude you obtain. This is, now you use the fact that that mu over rho is a diffusion coefficient, which is that you can write like a mean free path divided by the mean velocity of the molecule, which is of the order of the speed of the sound, this, and you add the fact that u is of the order of the acoustics, of the speed of acoustics. You use these two. And now you go ahead and you find immediately by comparison, you know, you put here a square here, rho a divided by now the thickness you are looking at, and you have this mu, and what do you find? You find that the thickness is of the order of the mean free path. So this tells you that you cannot use the macroscopic equation because it is a microscopic. Is that right? Microscopic and macroscopic? Is it a microscopic thickness? So you should go back to the kinetic theory of gases. That is, you should be back to Boltzmann equation. Good luck. Because Boltzmann equation, to solve Boltzmann equation, hopefully, the result obtained by Rankine show you that for a weak shock, you can do that. Why? Because the final result that I have written somewhere, here is the final result. Here's the final result. The final result show you that it is true that it is the thickness is of order of the mean free path. But if you have a small Mach number propagation, it is divided, mean free path divided by epsilon, which is a small difference between the Mach number and what. So what does that mean? That means when the Mach number of propagation, which is something close to acoustic, an acoustic bump that propagates with the acoustic speed, and now you can use macroscopic equation to solve the problem. What did Rankine? So let me finish. So here, this is the equation of the solution. This is, you know, mathematical result of the inner structure of a weak shock that I have written for you here. You will not find that easily in the literature. Let me see if you find that in the Landau book. Yes, you find that in the Landau book, but it is written in such a way that you cannot understand a word. Yeah. I hope that you can understand what I have written here. It's easy to follow. I did that for you. It's time to have a break now. I am very late compared to what I want to discuss, but there is no other way. I want you to understand.
I think you have another
15
minutes.
Oh, good. I am a stupid. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So I may go. Now, let me go to the Z and the structure of a detonation. We are talking about, thank you very much. We are talking about previously to the structure of the shock. Now, let me discuss the structure of the Zeldovich, of a detonation. A detonation, now, if you look to the order of magnitude of the following, assume that the activation energy is large compared to the thermal energy at the Neumann state just behind the shock. I told you that for a shock, strong shock, the thickness of the strong shock is of order of the mean free path. What does that mean? This means that there is no mini collision to go from the upstream condition to the compressed condition. You got that with very few elastic collision, but you know that to have a reaction, to have an exothermal reaction, you need many elastic collision because the activation energy is large. So what does that mean? That means that behind the shock, the reaction rate is quite negligible. You have to wait longer to have the reaction rate that develops. Because it is slow, much slower. The reaction rate is much slower than the rate of the elastic collision. Because there are inelastic collisions. This is my first lecture, or my second lecture. I don't remember very well. So this is written here. If the activation energy is large, the reaction rate at the Neumann state is much smaller than the collision rate, so that you have no burned gas in the just behind the shock wave. So that the conjecture of Viel is correct, that you should have a reaction, you should have first an inert shock wave, followed by an exothermal reaction, which is developed on much longer length or much longer time, because length and time are related by the flow velocity, much longer length than the thickness of the shock. So the detonation is you decouple the shock wave and the reaction. This is true is true for shock wave, for strong shock, but usually the heat release is sufficiently large so that the Chapman-Jouguet is such that the Mach number of a Chapman-Jouguet is 5, something like that. So if the Mach number is 5, you have a strong shock because M squared is 25, and so you have a strong shock. So this is diffusion rate. Now you have a second conclusion about that, very important, is because you are propagate, you have a velocity which is supersonic, the diffusion rate is much smaller than the reaction rate. So the diffusion terms are quite negligible to describe the evolution of the temperature and the concentration between the shock. The idea is the following. You have a shock. This is the velocity of the I am in the laboratory, in the frame of the moving shock. I see the gas arriving at T. And then the shock is inert, so I have the Neumann condition. And now this now a fluid particle is propagating with the Neumann flow. All right? And then, so times that you have a long, now if you have a distance, if you write the distance with the time is d. Okay, if you want to know where the temperature takes off, you have to, and you want to know this distance d, this is simply divided by un to r, this length, okay, it is un to r, the reaction. Okay? So you see, you do not need any diffusion. The diffusion mechanism change very, is negligible to change this profile. You just, it is like if you have a chemical reaction that is developing in a fluid particle and you follow the trajectory of the fluid particle. And this gives you a profile. That's all. This is the structure of the detonation. It is just the opposite of a flame. Transport phenomena are not useful to find out the internal structure of the reaction zone. However, all the dissipative phenomena are concentrated inside the shock wave. And you do not care about that because the shock wave, you describe that by jump condition, and you forget about it. So this is a very important conclusion. So the Zeidenday circuit, yeah, this is written here, clack, clack, up. Now, you can draw easily, you can write easily an equation for the structure. Here, I have written the equivalence of the evolution equation, which is now an equation explaining the spreading of the profile here. Here is, let's say, for example, this is a mass fraction of the limiting species, for example, which is the, and then you have to integrate that, this equation from Neumann state and let the evolution evolve and the reaction goes on. Now you can play with this and you can find out it's not difficult, it is written here, to obtain an equation of that form that tells you what is the slope of the velocity multiplied by the difference of the square of the sound minus the flow velocity in terms of the slope of the progress variable, which tells you how many heat you have released. Okay? This is the progress variable, it's called the progress variable. And this, it's true that this is going to depend on the multiple kinetics, on the details of a chemical kinetic. But to understand what I am going to say, it is not necessary. Now, if you have that, you obtain immediately an equation, but it is not really a closed equation because there is a speed of sound here and you do not know how it varies how the speed of sound is varying with U and Psi. So, but it, this form is very useful that you obtain immediately from that to understand the main feature of detonation. Here is the equation again, written in that form. And then you may integrate this equation using the conservation of energy and so on. And here is the result. You know, this, on the horizontal axis, I have the progress variable. It is zero at the Neumann state because there is no reaction at the Neumann state. So I integrate the equation from the Neumann state, okay? And I have different curve, okay? Now, if psi equals zero, in the conservation energy, you have two possibilities here. One is the Neumann state, and psi equals zero, this is a pure shock. There is no reaction. Okay, you have two states, the Neumann state and the initial state here. So you curve, the curve that you are going to draw by solving this equation numerically is that you have to be to start from here and to be back to the fresh mixture. It turns out that, you know, because you have in the denominator here a difference of a square and u square, the slope here become infinite at a particular value when u equal when the flow velocity equals the speed of sound. Because the flow velocity is first subsonic, because it is a flow relative to the shock. This is subsonic. Because this is subsonic, you are below. If the velocity, this equation, it tells you that you have to use the energy equation to obtain the expression of a square here. So this the solution depends on the velocity of the that you are considered. This is what is called an overdriven detonation. This is a detonation for which the speed of the gas in the burned gas is smaller than the speed of sound, is subsonic, and this is the case when you push with a piston, which is the case what is called an overdriven detonation. And the limiting case, and so you have to stop here, because you cannot have a progress variable larger than one. That is not possible to say that you cannot have a mass fraction of limiting spaces smaller than zero. It's impossible. So you have to stop here, and this is a Bern class. And now, if you decrease D, you arrive at this critical point here where you are vertical, because this is, and this is a Chapman-Jouguet structure. And if you still decrease now, there is no possibility to be back there is no more solution. You cannot go to psi, you cannot burn the mixture. So now sometimes there is a lot, I finished now with, okay. There are a lot of strange, not strange. Some people try to say, okay, detonations. Why cannot have a flame with why cannot have a reaction wave controlled by the diffusive process that propagates at a velocity close to the sound speed? I show you that it is impossible by dimensional analysis, but some people are still thinking about that. And they believe that this branch of solution has a meaning. But this branch of solution has no meaning because, you know, to start from this point, which is the initial mixture, to go to completion of the reaction, psi equal one, this is psi equal zero, is the initial state. You start from here, where the temperature is the temperature of the fresh mixture. And as you know, at the temperature of the fresh mixture, the reaction rate is infinite. So you cannot start. There is no starting effect. You stay where you are because the reaction rate is zero. So this has no meaning. And if you look for an attached wave to something, and you look to this supersonic flow, you will obtain a size of a width of the profile which is as large as the size of the universe, for example. You know? So this has no meaning at all to try to obtain solution starting from this point. You should start, as Viel has understood, from the Neumann state. From the Neumann state, it works well because now the reaction rate here is much higher than the reaction rate in the cold mixture, but it is still much slower than the elastic collision rate. This is why there is no reaction behind, but sufficiently to start the process, all right? So this is the subtlety of the detonation. And now I finish with the main point is the selection mechanism of the CJ wave. This picture shows you a piston that is pushing. This is the here are the velocity in terms of space. The piston here propagate and push the gas, and the gas is quite is uniform, and you have the reaction rate, and you have the shock here. What happens if you stop the piston? And this is an overdriven detonation. In that case, you should have a velocity larger than Chapman-Jouguet, as I show you. You should be above the critical condition. Eh? Otherwise, there is no solution. What happens when you stop? You stop the piston. Oh, I show you what happened. There is a rarefaction wave behind that developed to match the non-zero velocity of the gas, which was due initially to the piston, to the new velocity of the piston, which is zero. And this is a straight line in the remember that the profile of the velocity in an expanding wave is linear, but it increases in time. It is fully unsteady problem. So it is increasing time. Now you have something that I did not tell you, that now this smooth discontinuity here propagate with a sound velocity relative to the gas. But because you are overdriven here, the flow velocity is subsonic in such a way that now this point here is going to the distance here is going to decrease with time because this velocity here is larger than d. And so this point, the rarefaction wave, is coming close to the reaction rate. When it arrives at the reaction rate, it decreases the velocity, it slows down the velocity of the shock wave. And the shock wave decreases, and up to a time where the sound, you know, like in the construction of Shaman-Jugé, so you are here and you decrease. Okay, no, this is not good. Okay, the best is I give you the picture. Okay, I will finish with this. Where is it? Here, no. Here it is. Okay, you see, you decrease, because of the expanding wave behind you, the slope of this red curve here is decreasing, up, it reaches this point. But what happened at this point? That the velocity of the gas relative to the shock is sonic, and the relative velocity of this point here, which is a weak discontinuity, this I did not prove that, but it is not difficult to prove it, is also sonic relative to the, excuse me. Okay, but the relative velocity of this point relative to the gas is sonic. So when you reach the Shapman-Jugé regime, this point, the leading edge of the rarefaction wave, is stuck at the end of the reaction. And then the flame propagates, the detonation propagates without piston. And you have this expanding wave increasing with time. And when sufficiently far away, you may completely neglect this rarefaction wave because the slope is negligible. Okay. If you can do only 10 minutes breaks.